Two. Hey, welcome everyone to another Let's Talk Dissect here of The Walking Dead. This time we're talking about the first half of season two. I'm here with my buddy James, who just wrestled his kid down to sleep, hopefully for a little bit. How's everything going, James, since the last time we talked to
Just another day.
you?
The baby's sleeping through the night, so kind of got a little bit of energy back, but putting him down tonight was a little bit of a struggle, but he's quiet and sleeping now, so that's good.
Good progress. Perfect. All right, let's jump into season two. If you missed the last session here, we talked about season one. From here on out, we'll be doing half seasons. That's kind of how The Walking Dead has been chopped up anyway, and I think it gives us a good opportunity to dissect them and not lose sight of too many episodes in between there. Also allows us to fill in the gaps in between the breaks that they do.
So we're going to be talking about episodes 1 through 7. This is a 15 episode, sorry, 16, 17, 18. Wait a second. I don't know what the hell I'm talking about.
13.
13 episode season. So, is the it's the it's it's not quite a full season in season 2. The full season started in season as of season 3, where it's 16 episodes. So, you got episodes more talk about episodes 1 through 7 today, and I'll get into Herschel's farm, and the continuation of the survivor's journey from the CDC center that exploded, and where they go next. And I just said it, Herschel's farm. And what do you think about this season, Jay? Season 2. This is when Jay and I started watching the show together. Me, my wife, Jay, and his wife. Way back when, huh?
Yeah, it seems forever ago now.
Man.
I still can't believe it. It was pretty solid. It's a different take on it. Slowed things down. Where the central piece is obviously try to find, what's the name there?
Sophia.
Sophia. Yeah, of course. Blank on that. And everything else kind of rotating around
Yeah,
that,
you mentioned
that's a
it about.
central piece of the puzzle. But introduce some new characters, some recurring characters, obviously, and
Iconic comic book characters.
yes.
I like this season. Simply for the fact that it extended Shane's story.
Oh yeah,
A
yeah.
lot of people say this is one of the worst seasons in the series, but I disagree because it again, I believe that you do need some story. And you do need to, build up this rivalry between Rick and Shane. And I think that they had to do that when they extended Shane's character. I mean, it killed him off in the comic. We already know that that's different. But I think that they did a good job showing this love triangle, and trying to give the viewers a sense of hope, and they did that throughout season two, especially the first half of the season. They made the survivors put their heads together to look for Sophia. So it showed, their journey, how their journey was interrupted, the introduction of the horde, or the herd. Showed the Herschel's farm, so it had a lot of big moments and a lot of moments that weren't in the comic book. So I you can appreciate that. And like I said, just they did slow it down a bit, but
Yeah.
it was really resolved at the end of the season. We'll
And
get
even
into.
when I'm thinking back now, I think about it was slowed down, but it wasn't slowed down that much. You think so many of these key events that happened. You have the Shane episode there with Otis. You have Sophia, like you said, the first time encountering a herd. You have Carl getting shot.
You
What
have
else was
Trooper
it? Yeah,
Cabra.
the Chupacabra. Yep.
The first episode, that was like Daryl's coming out party, I think.
Yeah.
I mean, and also what people seem to forget is it developed Daryl's character. This is what made Daryl a legend in the show. And it was season two that Daryl became Daryl. You know, he was no longer, you know, Merle's little brother. He was no longer a pain in the ass. He became himself and a leader. And they even said that later on in the season. We'll get into that next week. But, you know, Carol had a line that said, "You're just as good as Rick and Shane." And it showed you his development and his growth in one season. That's why everybody loved Daryl, was because of season two. So when people look at season two and say, "Oh, it sucked, it's boring," you know, look back at the big moments that you got in season two. Look back at, you know, the character development of Daryl, you know, the extension of Shane's character. You know, look at, even if I'm not an Andrea fan, but look at Andrea's development. Look at Maggie's introduction. Look at Maggie and Glenn's relationship and how it began.
Oh yeah,
you got a lot of big moments there, and it's you got Herschel's farm. At the end of the season, you had incredible events that happened that we'll get into next week. But this was a solid season if you really sit back and think about it. I think that because the 6-episode season one, I think it was action packed with maybe one filler episode there. Mm-hmm. I think that the fans were spoiled and thought that that was what the series was going to be about, nonstop zombie action. But you can't tell a story that way. So season two being an extended season from 6 episodes to 13, you know, it kind of had to stretch it out a little bit. And I think they did a good job. So I like season two. It's one of is top is in the it might be my third or fourth favorite season, you know. I got to give it to him. I got to give Kirkman and the producers, you know, Nicotero did great with the, did great with the makeup.
Left course. Yeah.
And it was a great all around season. And I think that they, like we said before, you know, got a lot of those iconic moments, and then they made a lot of iconic moments. So, you know, season two, first half was pretty neat, man. I liked it. You know, it's pretty good.
Yeah, and this is another scene was when Shane and Andrew are out there in the little complex there, just like some more of those little action packed scenes. And like I said, like slowed down at the same time. There's still some action, you know, going on out there, and you know, it kept us on the toes because we're a fan of comics. You're not sure what's gonna happen now because you have Shane in there, and how's he gonna affect everything?
Yep.
You know, Tyrese isn't in there. We'll get to that, but I think overall, I definitely enjoy it. I think just thinking back now on it, I think I enjoyed it even more than I first thought. Like you said, it's new characters, it's new blood, it's some people around still, and it definitely shows you the danger is right around the corner.
Yeah, and it's I think it's nostalgic for me as well because again, this is, you know, our show is Jay and James, so it's. We watched this. This is the first season, you know, we actually, it was almost like, you know, Jay and his wife would come over our apartment and we watch it together. So it was like, you know, it was kind of like the first season we actually watched together. So it's nostalgic. We were reviewing the season going on and trying to figure out what was going to happen. We were on the edge of our seats in season two more so than any season because of, you know, you know, where Sophia, the herds, Herschel's farm. So it was just a lot of events, and you know, to experience them, just be able to watch them together and stuff. It was a big deal. So you know, I take that as part of why I really like season two as well. But that's selfish reasons. But but logical reasons would show you that this season wasn't as slow as you may think it was. And like Jay said, there was a lot of action in there, a lot of action.
Jumping back on the Daryl comment, I think, like you said, it established him not only as the smarts, the brains of the survivalist, the fighter, but he's also a lover now, too. You know, he's trying to take care of Sophia. He's got that emotional side, which, you know, all the girls swoon over now. He's handsome, and he's got a good heart.
Showed his sensitive side, as they would say. And you know what? So, you know, to start the season off, you know, they had the episode What Lies Ahead. And that in itself was an incredible episode. It was an hour and a half, and the first shot that they showed was Atlanta.
Mm-hmm.
And they showed it, and it was narrated by Rick's voice on the walkie-talkie to try to reach Morgan. Because at this point, Rick is still trying to keep in touch with Morgan via walkie-talkie. And it shows you that he's unsuccessful at doing it. So that's another thing that they're showing is society's breaking down. Everything is breaking down. Even communication mm-hmm. is breaking down. So they give you that glimpse that nothing is getting better at this point. Nothing. Yeah. So
and that, Rick is and then he's still holding on to a little bit.
Still holding on to hope.
Yeah.
And he's on the rooftop, and they hit you with that first cliffhanger when he said, you know, Jenner told me, he told me, and then he cuts it out and says, it doesn't matter. What matters is, you know, it kind of like teases the audience, but it does it in such a creative way that it puts it in the back of your head, but it also makes you look forward to the rest of the episode without dwelling over what Jenner's talking about, you know? And, you know, and it concludes with the group has now decided to take Shane's advice and go to Fort Benning.
Yeah.
So Rick has admitted that he failed for CDC and it didn't work out the way he wanted it to. And now they have to go in a different direction.
It's
plan B. And along the way, you know, you see, you know, the journey continuing, and it seems like everything is going to go according to plan, according to Shane's plan. And then the introduction of the herd comes, and the trap in the congested highway, when they have to stop and get supplies and repair the RV. So
I do think they could have done a better job of showcasing how that herd actually snuck up on them. Because Dale's up there with binoculars, and all of a sudden there's like 100 zombies and, you know, 100 walkers, and pretty sure you have seen them, you know?
True.
But
true.
I'll let that one slide.
Yeah, you know, because they did, you know, in defense of that, they did switch posts, and they were kind of talking about different things, and Shane found that truck full of water bottles. So, you know, they were distracted by the reveals of, you know, the finding of supplies and the scavenge that they were on. So I could see how they could lose track of it. And remember, they've never seen anything like this before. They've probably seen a couple of zombies.
Yep.
And they probably said, okay, they're far away. So, you know, when they got back onto the roof of the RV, you see the shot was started to pan out, and Rick's direct vision only showed a couple of zombies, and it wasn't until he looked over to his right that you start to see this massive group coming.
Yeah.
So, you know, again, that's an important part of the Walking Dead's universe is the herd. And if you're keeping up with the comics now, and the last comic that came out was issue 162, if you're keeping up with that, and a lot of people haven't read it and don't read the comics, but if you have read up to 162, you know that the herd itself is the biggest threat in the comic book right now. So the herd's introduction in the show at this point shows that they will become they are always a threat, but now they've become an enormous threat.
It's like a character in itself.
And they showed the herd the first season in Atlanta, but that was, you know, that it wasn't exaggerated like it was in season two.
Right, they're enclosed. It's like, well, of course they're going to be all congregated. Where are they going to go?
Yep. And, you know, and then they followed up what lies ahead. You know, they actually hide from the herd. Andrea, it was almost like Andrea's, first zombie kill, you could say, first walker kill.
And the first time she gave Dale the stink eye. Like, how dare you keep me alive? I should be dead.
Yeah.
You son of a bitch.
It showed the relationship developing there. Mm. And then it showed almost like a forgiveness between T-Dog and Daryl. And an understanding that, you know, that they were a group. Daryl did a lot of things in this episode and future episodes to basically become part of the group. And in the first episode, you know, when they lost, when they hid from the herd underneath the cars, and Sophia, you know, you know, when Sophia alerted one of the walkers to her location, yeah. you know, and she ran away, and, you know, Rick also showed his, you know, showed his leader capabilities, you know, his leader qualities and characteristics when he chased her first. And when Sophia's lost in the woods and Rick finds her, and Rick leads her to a temporary safe haven, and he goes back to the, you know, he goes back to lead the walkers away from her, and she's gone, it gave you a new problem of the group, a new adventure, and that's when Sophia disappeared. So that was all in the first episode alone. So a lot of people who say it was boring, I take you back to that first episode, which was incredible. So, you know, you had so many different elements of the show in that one episode. And it now put the group on this search and find rescue mission of Sophia. So
now, do you think with Darryl, this probably stems from him growing up and everything, he probably never felt like he belonged to, you know, he's always either beaten by, you know, was beaten up by his older brother or his family. Mm-hmm. You know, his family being rednecks, him being getting lost down the woods and being kind of left alone out there, coming home, mm-hmm. no one's like looking for him. They're just like, mm-hmm. oh, there he is. You know, great.
Sense of belonging. Mm-hmm. And I think that they showed you that. And I think that in episode one, when at the end of episode one, when Carl at the end episode one, Carl actually gets shot just like in the comic books.
Yeah.
Otis shoots him. Obviously, Rick and Shane break off from the group, and Carl insists on going with them. And Carl gets shot while he comes face to face with a deer or a buck, and it's a moment of tranquility, and everything seems okay, and there's hope, and, you know, Carl is walking up to this buck. he looks as if the buck is, you know, returning the gaze of Carl, and then all of a sudden Otis, who's tracking the buck, shoots the buck, and the bullet goes through and hits Carl. So not only do you have Sophia lost, not only do you have the group encountering the herd, not only do you have now that they have to break away from their plan of going, now they're delaying their plan of going to Fort Bennington. Now you have Carl getting shot. So now you don't know if Carl's dead. You have a group on the highway. You have T-Dog cut his arm. There's so many different things that happen in episode one that set this up. So it's like when I hear it's slow, it was boring, it was horrible. No, it, you know, look back at it, and that's what Jay said last week. If you're able to watch these things again, mm-hmm. you know, you watch them, you kind of yeah. get an appreciation of it, and it's just incredible. That first episode was incredible. So, and then, like you said, it was a sense of belonging. Daryl, the first thing Daryl did was he started to help in the scavenge for supplies. Mm-hmm. You know? And the second thing he did was he saved T-Dog's life. You know, T-Dog cut himself and was bleeding, and zombies obviously, you know, have the scent of blood. But Daryl actually, you know, put the dead body of the dead walker on top of T-Dog to mask his smell.
Oh, he definitely saved T-Dog's life. Without Daryl being life. There, he would have been gone.
Exactly. And he said, we got to go find this little girl. He led the charge with Rick, mm-hmm. you know. Shane didn't really want to. It was Rick and Daryl who really led this charge. And it became Daryl's personal mission to find this little girl because of what happened to him as a child. And he explained that. When I was a kid, man, nobody came looking for me. I was lost in the woods for 3 days. You know, and I got poison ivy on my ass. You know, so, you know, he... You know, it showed this different side of him. And as I said before, if you watch the show and you love Daryl, you love Daryl because of season two. You don't love Daryl because of what he's doing now. You love him for what he developed from season two. And that was important, obviously.
He says so many layers for me. He's the survivalist. He's the romancer. He's the you know, the bad guy everyone loves. But he's also, he's got the fragileness of him. And everyone's like, I can fix him.
Yeah. and then after Carl was shot in episode two, we get to meet Herschel Green, and probably at this point in the comic, one of the top four, maybe the third or fourth biggest character in the comics in Maggie Green. And as we all know, if you watch this series, Maggie Green is the sole survivor of the Green family at this point. But you get to meet her family at this point and where she came from, and her development as a character, because she was a farm girl. She was a farmer girl at this time.
Yeah.
And she has hidden strengths that, you know, she rode the horse and she alerted the rest of survivors that Carl was shot and Lori needed to go back to the farm. You know, but she was still rough around the edges, you know. So
now
you got to meet that. You got to see that. Go ahead, Jay.
Her viewpoint of the walkers seems to switch back and forth a little bit here. At some point, she agrees with her father that they're still human. But the first time you see her encounter the walker, you know, she's riding a horseback and smacks him in the head with a baseball bat.
She doesn't want to kill them.
Right.
I think that she saw that as a threat, and she is still looking at the walkers as people. So you see a woman getting assaulted by, in her mind, probably a sick man. And she knows that these creatures or these people in her mind at the time, you know, have a sickness, and they could spread the sickness through bites. So, you know, she knows this, and she sees this, and she's been brainwashed by her father that these people can be cured. So when she hits the walker in the head, she doesn't kill him. She hits him, knocks him off, and as you know, after she tells Lori to come with her, Daryl is saying, we can't let her go with this girl. We don't know this girl. And then, you know, Lori leaves, and everybody's looking at Daryl, and then the walker sits up. He goes, shut up, bitch. And he shoots the walker that Maggie hit. So I don't think that she went to kill the walker. Yeah. I think she just hit the walker to save Andrea. So, you know, she's drinking the Kool-Aid of her father. You know, her father's saying, these are people. We can't kill them. We could cure them. And then she starts to see that they're dangerous, you know. So she does have that, you know, perception of them as still being people with a sickness, and it changes. And her character, and it's important to realize the growth of her character, because she shows leader characteristics as well. And she shows that she's developing and growing into this, you know, a leader type character that she is now.
Well, she definitely took charge. Just like, where's your wife? I'll go get her. Jumps on the horse, takes off.
Season 2 started this. So
yeah, no gun, nothing. Just, I'll be fine. Don't worry about it.
Exactly. And she was going on scavenger hunts, you know, into walker-infested areas by herself.
Yeah.
So, you know, you have this sense of strength from Maggie from the get-go, but she was rough around the edges. She was still under her father's reign. She still respected her father's law and her father's rule and the rule of the farm. But it slowly changed as the season went on, you know, and it came from her relationship with Glenn, you know. Yeah. And Glenn developed, and he started to grow up in this season as well. So you're starting to see these, and it goes back to what I said in on last week's episode. These characters are shedding their former lives and becoming something else. So, you know, and season 2 shows the transition from your past life to post-apocalypse life. So,
now, with Sophia, had Shane been in charge, how long do you think he would stay in search for her?
I think that they would have searched the night. I think that after Carl got shot, I think he would have stayed until Carl was helped, because remember, Carl got shot.
Yep.
While they were looking. I think he had a due diligence if he wanted these people to follow him, to show that he was going to try to look for this little girl. I think his excuse of staying was Carl getting shot, and his excuse for Carl being shot was, we look for this little girl. But he still would have looked for this little girl, because he was all about Lori and Carl, and there was no way Lori was going to leave without trying to find Sophia. So Shane would have at least stayed that night and until Carl got, you know, till Carl recovered. But shortly after that, he would have left.
Do you think he would have lied to the group, say something like, I found her, she turned, I had to put her down, don't go find her, it's, you know, you don't want to see her like this, yada, 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 we should get going.
You know what? They hinted that Shane was going to do something like that, and yes, he would have done something like that. They hinted that Shane was going to lie to get people to see his way later on in the season. Mm-hmm. We could give that up because that's not really a lie. He lied to Lori later on in the season that Rick and Glenn had returned to the farm. Yeah. So Shane is willing to tell a white lie, you know, to protect Lori and Carl, and also to get people to follow his lead.
Yeah.
So I think that they hinted on it, and he even lied about Otis, and that's coming up soon. So you know, Shane is a manipulator, mm-hmm. and he uses the excuse that he loves Lori and Carl and keep them safe no matter what to be a manipulator. So you start to see this in the things that he says and his little conversation with Andrea when they're outside of the church. You start to see him changing. And again, it's another character change. And it was an iconic moment for Shane. And I think that season two Shane is a brand new character because, remember, he died in the comic books.
Yeah.
So season two Shane is already dead in my mind. Season one Shane is dead in my mind. Season two Shane is born when he shaves his hair after he kills Otis. So it's like it's an iconic moment when they start off the episode Save the Last One.
Mm-hmm.
They start off that episode with Shane shaving his head, and you know, a lot of the women loved it because he had his shirt off and he's moving his man titties, and a lot of the women were, you know, they got all excited about that and couldn't control themselves, you know. But that was his coming out party, and you know, when he's shaving his head at the beginning of the episode, I remember we sat in the living room, and Jay and I said, "Oh boy, what the hell's going on?" You know, and you know,
girls Shane 2.0. That's
what it is. Exactly. So it was like they hit you with what happened. They hit you with the post event before, you know, the episode showed. So
yeah,
you know, obviously this goes back to episode two when Shane goes with Otis to go get the medical supplies to save Carl. So episode three is Shane, you know, has to make a choice. He's hurt. He's injured from two-story jump from the school building. He's injured. He's badly injured. His ankle is injured. Otis is overweight. He's not fast.
Yeah.
Shane knows one of them, they're both not going to survive. One of them has to go. And Shane knew that he wasn't going to leave it as a choice of Otis to sacrifice himself. Shane had to make that choice, and Shane killed Otis to get away and to save Carl.
Do you think Shane is the first person in the group then to kind of, like, his hair shed away his previous life, like accepting, you know, the world it is now?
He is absolutely the first person to do so, and he was a pioneer for the group because his actions taught the group a valuable lesson. You cannot, and this is what we talked about last week, when I answered the question, who would you be? You cannot survive in a post-apocalyptic world such as this if you are not willing to make changes and become a survivor. And Shane did this, and he led the way throughout the season saying, you have to make these choices to live. You can't be what you were before. He even said it. It's not how it used to be, Rick. He said it.
Yep.
And that was key. It's not how it used to be, Rick. And he lived that when he sacrificed a human being to save another human being. When he made the decision to go and get those supplies to save another human being, put his life on the line. You know, when he made the tough decision to break into the barn, we'll get into that. You know, he showed, hey, look, this is how we survive now. We can't take chances like this.
And, like, some of the conversations, too, like when him and Rick are walking through the woods and they're talking about his, you know, his high school exploits with the women.
Yeah.
And he's like, we're talking like we're old people because everyone in the stories are all dead.
Yeah.
You know, and he accepts that, but Rick's still kind of like, oh, don't say that. You know, it's like.
Yeah, and he said it. It's nostalgia. It's nostalgia. Yeah. You got to let that go. It gets you killed.
Yeah.
It's over. These people are dead. Yeah. And, you know, and it was really good it was a really good transition piece that they did when Rick is telling a story about Shane stealing the principal's car and how he had to run all the way back from town before the bell rang, and they show him running from the zombies and going on this mission. It was almost like he was always an adventurer. He was always the person who went on these crazy missions, suicide missions. Yeah. As a teenager, you would never think of stealing your principal's car and filling it up with chicken shit.
It was a school too. So
exactly. It shows that he's willing to do stuff like that. But going on, so he kills Otis. And then you get the reveal that he kills Otis. Obviously the survivors don't know it, but the fans get to see that he did it. He sheds his hair.
Yeah.
He makes up a lie and says that Otis died a survivor. And the one person that doesn't buy it is Daryl.
Yeah.
And I think that was Daryl's coming out party as well. And I think if you go back to episode 2, Rick tries to shoo Daryl away, saying, hey, we set up camp. We no longer need your help. You can be on your way. And Daryl said, my plans fell through, meaning him and his brother were supposed to rob these people. But the plans fell through, and that was his excuse of staying because he was part of something. He didn't want, subconsciously, he didn't want to leave that. So, that was his coming out party. And then when Shane is telling his story in Chupacabra, Daryl decides, hey, look, this guy is a liar. I can't stay around for this. I'm going to look for Sophia.
Yeah, basically, he was like, I don't want to get involved. I mean, he knew the outcome. He knew that Shane killed all his people. He's like, I'm not going to tell anyone. I'm just going to.
Yep.
That's not more stay, important right now is saving course. Sophia.
Yes. Focus on the task ahead. And that's what he did. And that's a leadership quality right there.
He doesn't need his high school politics going on over here.
Doesn't. And you have Herschel wanting the group to leave because, they're killing walkers. He believes they're people. You have Maggie saying to Glenn, these are my family. They're not walkers. You have Lori at the end of the episode. Actually, this is the first episode Maggie and Glenn has sex. It was kind of a funny, awkward moments there where they were in the, they were on a scavenger run, and Lori sent Glenn to go get a pregnancy test. And Maggie and Glenn consummated their relationship. But at the end of the episode, it was a reveal that Lori was pregnant. And it was also an episode that had Glenn almost die for the second time. Glenn almost died a third time, and he almost died in a well with the well zombie. So there was a little bit of tension there.
Yep.
Obviously, there was tension of now Lori's pregnant. You get your first pregnant woman in a zombie apocalypse. A first.
This group just can't take catch a break. Jeez. Yeah.
So as much as we want to say it was slow, you have all these events coming up one after another hitting the group, and it just reminds you that life still goes on, and it just gets shittier because of the zombie apocalypse. So, you had that. You had the return of Merle Dixon in a hallucination from Daryl. You had Daryl having to, basically turn into Daryl. I think that's when Daryl died. When he fell down that mountain and he punctured he impaled himself with the arrow. I think that was the death of the old Daryl Dixon and the rebirth of what everybody loves.
Yeah.
Because all of a sudden he turns into the god of the show.
It's him staying up for himself. It's not him just playing coy to his brother. It's him saying, "No, I'll prove you wrong. I will climb this mountain."
And it was he climbed the mountain and became a man. It was like his coming out party.
And he also chose a group over Merle too, where it's like, exactly. "Oh, Rick did good by us. They're good people."
Yes. Yes. And he, it was like, you watch the movie 300 when the boy goes into the cave and he has to fight the tiger and then he comes back with the teeth. Well, Daryl fought the walkers and he came back with the ears. Yep. It was a trophy of a conquest. So he comes back, and then this is when everybody hated Andrea when she shot him.
Well, you can't blame people. You know, I mean, God, don't shoot him. All right, I'm gonna. Shoot. You know, everyone's telling her not to. And yeah. It's just like, oh.
Yeah. And you know, and that's another big, that was another big episode. And then you got episode 6. Obviously, Daryl survives. Andrea just gave him a nick. And then you had Secrets, which was Glenn finding, actually, at the end of Chupacabra, Glenn finds the walkers in the barn, which is just like the comic books.
Yep.
In episode 6, he goes and tells Dale and the group there's walkers in the barn. This is when Shane gets pissed off.
I love that scene where he just takes off running and is like, what the hell are you talking about? You know, just sprinting towards it.
Yep. And then at the end of Secrets was another iconic moment that did not happen in the comic books. Mm-hmm. It was the moment that, well, it did happen in comic books, but it wasn't played out the way it did in the show. So at the end of the episode, Rick finds out that Lori is pregnant, and he finds out because Lori took morning after pills, that she had Glenn go and get her. And Rick sees that Lori took these pills, and he finds the box, and he confronts Lori about it. And he says to Lori, you know, you give me shit about, you know, keeping something secrets, from you.
Yeah.
You give me shit about keeping secrets from you.
Yeah.
But you keep something like this from me.
Yeah.
And Rick also has some sort of sense that something happened between Shane and Lori. He has this in the back of his head because he says this.
He can sense it.
And Lori says, he goes, Lori, is there anything else I need to know about? And the biggest dramatic moment in the show was Lori saying, yes, you know, Shane and I. And he knew it.
Yeah.
So it's like, now you have this thing that, is this my baby? You know, and that wasn't revealed until season 7. You know,
it could still be Rick's, you know, there's no blood tests out there, so.
I'm gonna say it. Shane.
It's Shane.
I'm just gonna go out there on a limb and say it was Shane. But you know,
then having that baby, it's literally planting the seeds for the future of the show.
Yeah, so I'm gonna go out with it with Shane's. But so you have that reveal, and then one of my favorite episodes in the show was pretty much dead already. And that was when the group comes to a head. They finally make a decision. Rick has to beg Herschel. He begs Herschel, you gotta let us stay here. My wife is pregnant.
Yep.
And Herschel still is not, he's still not accepting this. He still wants to send them on away. And that's when Maggie turns around and says, hey, look, Dad, I thought the same thing you did. This goes back to what Jay said earlier in the show. I thought these were people until they almost killed me, they almost killed Glenn. I saw one of these people get ripped in half and still move. These aren't people. The people that are here trying to live here are people. These are zombies. So she talked him in to letting Rick and the group stay. And Herschel, still believing that these are people, took Rick on this zombie scavenger hunt.
Because he wants to kind of show Rick his point of view. It's like, maybe I can turn them into, you know, my side. Yes.
And he takes Rick and he tells Rick, you're not going to kill anymore. If you're going to stay, you got it. This is my farm, my barn, my rules.
Mm-hmm.
So on the way back with the walkers, this is when Shane loses.
What the hell is this? It's almost comical because, you know, I couldn't imagine just like seeing that. Like, you got to be kidding me.
And he went nuts.
Yeah, calls the bluff. It starts shooting the zombie in the chest. It's like the same.
But this is also alive. This is also after the reveal that Rick says to Shane, "We have to stay here," and Shane is like, "We have to go." Carl's okay. We have to go. And Rick says, "Lori's pregnant." Yeah. So now Shane wants to clean out the barn anyways.
Yeah.
Because now Shane wants to stay because he thinks it's his kid. But he's right. He's 100% right. If Maury Povich was alive, they could have a show and sit Rick and Shane down. And, you know, Lori would be all, it looks like Rick. You know, the crowd would cheer for Rick. And then Maury would read it. Rick Grimes, you are not the father. And then Lori would, you know. Lori would fall on the floor and cry, and you know, Glenn and Daryl will be in the audience, and then they would say Shane's the father, and people will boo and boo Lori, you know, all that other bullshit. But yep. Anyways, so
and Daryl, but I knew it. I knew it the whole time.
Shane sees this. He has this in his head that this is my child. I have to keep my child safe. So he wants to clean out the barn. So he sees Rick bringing these walkers, and he just loses it. Goes and busts open the barn. And what does he find? All of Herschel's family and then Sophia.
The very end. Yep. So that's how you end a mid-season.
Now, that was an incredible show.
Had they shown the reactions of the cast and then like cut away and then wait till the next season of the show, like what actually happened? I'm like, so dumb.
That would have been horrible. Yeah. But you know, it all led up to it. You know, Chupacabra, mm-hmm. when Daryl found the Cherokee Rose.
Yeah.
I mean, Cherokee Rose. The episode he found the Cherokee Rose and it showed hope.
Yeah.
You know, showing the rose to Carol and saying, "Hey, look,
found
a teddy bear. There's hope in Chupacabra. So yeah. There's all this hope. T-Dog is saved. There's an Easter egg from Breaking Bad in this episode with the blue meth. And Merle's chlamydia, you know, his amoxicillin
bag there,
and dicyclamine that he has in his bag, you know, so he has this to cure up these STDs, and he has a bag of meth and saved T-Dog's life. T-Dog gets sewn up. Glenn saves Maggie's life. Glenn doesn't die from the walker well. You know, Carl is saved. All this stuff about hope. It's making you think, oh, Daryl got shot and he didn't die. It's making you think they're going to find Sophia, and they find her in the barn dead.
Yeah.
It crushes you. It crushes everything you have to believe in hope and reminds you that this is not the movies, you know, in a weird way.
Because, like, your attention's, like, adrenaline's going because they just killed a bunch of zombies coming out of the barn. Yep. And, like Shane's just like, these are humans. And it's, like, big revelation to Herschel. He's breaking down over there. The family's crying because, you know, they're seeing their loved ones, you know, to their eyes possibly killed again, you know. And then the group's just not been almost, like, distracted by everything. They almost, like, forgot about Sophia there for a second because they're so focused on the current situation. And then she comes out.
I think they gave up. I think that they gave up. Hope. Mm-hmm. And it was almost like they had all this hope for everything else, and they just lost track, and they just gave up hope on Sophia. Yeah.
They're looking to the future more than the present right now, and what really reason why they're even there.
Yep. And Sophia walks out, and after the entire group except for Rick mows down the zombies and Herschel's family that were turned.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody in the group can pull a weapon to kill their own. And Rick was the first one to say, we have to do, if we're going to do this to his, if we're going to show, we're going to prove a point that these are walkers and not people anymore.
Yeah.
We can't be prejudiced to the fact that this is a walker and not Sophia. And Rick pulled out his coat python and he put her down. Just like he did in episode one, the first episode, that coat python put down a little girl.
Yeah.
It was precluding what he was going to do, what he's going to have to do in the future. It was iconic moment linked with an iconic moment.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the best, one of the best episodes in the series. And that came in season two. That was the best, one of the best mid-season finales in the season, in the series, was pretty much dead already.
Oh, I agree. And, you know, it has all that energy. You know, and then at the same time, you're
sucked
pumped,
it right
and
out of
then
me.
it's like, yeah, just hollow. It's like, no, not her. Like, literally, like, the
Exactly.
most innocent person, you know, in the group. Of course, the other one is shot in the chest, so.
Yeah.
Bad time for kids.
Yeah, and it's like, you see that they show you that nobody's safe, even the kids. No, the kids aren't safe.
If you're a kid or a horse in The Walking
yeah,
Dead, you're gonna have a bad day, apparently.
You're gonna have a bad day, very bad day. Sophia is the second child in the show to die. The first child was the first girl that Rick killed. Sophia is, at this point, the second child to die. And it's like, it was such a crushing blow to the viewer, because you actually didn't know what happened to Sophia, because in the comic book, she's still alive. So
yeah.
Even comic book readers were like, you know, Sophia, they'll find Sophia. She'll be all right.
Yeah, they can't write her off because, you know, she has a big storyline.
She's
and
in the
stuff
comic.
Like that.
She has a huge. She's still alive in the comic
yeah,
books.
But, you know, that's just another like twist for comic book fans. Like, holy crap, we have no idea what's going to happen now.
No idea what's going to happen next. And it was such a crushing blow.
Oh yeah.
And it's set up for a great second half of the season, what we'll get into next week.
Because it leaves the question is like, what will the group do now? There's no reason for them to be there besides for safety of Lori. So now what?
Yes.
I mean, they just killed Herschel's family. He probably doesn't want them there.
No.
You know, so there's the conflict there. So now what?
And it just shows you that the decision that Shane made to clear out the barn was, you know, was completely emotional. It was illogical.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't necessary.
Mm-hmm.
And Rick, at this point, is still in his ways of the old world, where he's trying to find a peaceful resolution. And even though Shane's methods were aggressive and illogical and unnecessary in our minds, the question to the viewer was it unnecessary in those times, in this new world? Was that the necessary thing to do? And mind you, all this shit that's going down, the survivors are not quite survivors at this point. They've lost track of everything that they learned in season one. You can't make noise. You utilize and, you know, ration your supplies and ammunition. You have to keep fires low. They were very cognizant of this in season one when they were in the camp. And they, even when Glenn came with the red Mustang, Shane got pissed at Glenn for making all that noise and knew that the walkers were going to find them because of the noise. Rick said the gunshot will be heard for miles when he shot Leon Bassett.
Yeah.
Why are they killing the walkers with guns? You know, they lose track of this. And it cost them later on.
They got too comfortable. You know, that's what happens. They got settled in and they took a step back.
They lost their sense. Mm-hmm. And that's how they still are wet behind the ears when it comes to being survivors. And season two shows this, man. You just got to pay attention to it. And, you know, they lose track of all the things that they learned because they became comfortable, like Jay said. And.
All right, so let's talk about what's different then between the show and the comics, such as Sophia being dead now in the show.
Okay.
Shane being alive. So they kind of trade. Sometimes they do that. Yep. One's alive because the other one's dead.
Again, Daryl Dixon.
Yep, Daryl Dixon's not in the comics at all, so complete wild card.
Andrea and Dale's relationship is different.
Yep, in the comics they develop a
romantic
relationship.
Okay.
Another character missing is Tyrese. You know,
Tyrese.
In the comics he becomes Rick's right hand man.
He was replaced by T-Dog in a sense.
Mm-hmm.
And T-Dog wasn't the right hand man. I think Daryl was starting to step up as Rick's right hand man in this this show. There's no Beth. There is no Patricia.
Yep.
There's no Jimmy.
Yeah, those people exist in the comics. They have other names in the comics.
Other names, other people.
Yeah.
Beth's character, she was another sister of Maggie's, but she was dead. She was in the barn with Beth, Maggie's mother and brother. Otis was a different character. He was a little bit racist. and he wasn't the same character. He didn't, obviously Shane is dead, so Shane didn't kill Otis.
Yeah.
Otis is still alive. That's a difference. Oh man, there's a couple of them. Sophia wasn't lost. That's a huge difference.
There's no reason. So they're on the road and they encounter Tyrese out there. Right on the road there where they lost Sophia. Mm-hmm. That's actually where Lori tells Rick about being pregnant too.
Yep.
She comes out with it herself. Okay. And then a missing piece in there. Before the farm is the Wilshire Estates.
Wilshire Estates. But you know what? They showed in an Easter egg to the comic books. They showed Wilshire Estates, and it was called Shire Wilt, I think it was. It was backwards. Because that's where...
Was that Noah's family? Is that where they're from?
No, Noah's family was from Wiltshire. No, they were from Shire Wilt. But they showed Wiltshire. I think it was twisted in a way, because that's where Shane and Andrea went to go look for Sophia.
That's right, yeah.
Yeah, so they kind of gave you that comic book, you know, Easter egg, because they did stop there.
Yeah.
That's when they, you know, they decided that Sophia was never there.
Yeah. In the comics, they go there for like a night, thinking they're in a safe.
And it was overrun.
Yeah. They didn't realize until the next morning.
And you know what's in the comic? I mean, it's breaking off a little bit, but in the comic book, if you read the governor's special, the governor finds Wiltshire first, and he's the one. The governor's the one who writes the sign. All dead, do not enter.
Yeah. You know,
so that was the governor who wrote that sign in the comic book that Rick found. So it was like they passed, you know, briskly through the night. It's
a couple weeks before that, they could have crossed paths before. Yeah.
And so now in the show, they just show Andrea and Shane going, and this is when Andrea becomes this, you know, revelation that now she's a experienced assassin. And she realizes that she's a sure shot and that she's gained her confidence and wants to live. So, you know, it was a lot, man. I thought about it. A lot of people say they hated season two. And I see it online that people didn't like season two. And I got to say, man, looking back at it, man, this was a great set. Especially
They need to go back and rewatch it like we did, because just rewatching it, like, we missed so much in there. There's one more difference. So the barn was a little bit different, the confrontation. There's no Shane in the comics at the time.
Nope.
So Herschel was actually trying to put in a zombie into the barn.
And they broke loose.
Yeah, they broke loose, which then killed one of his sons and one of his daughters.
Yep.
And then you see where he almost wanted to commit suicide, but Rick stopped him.
This is the first time he wanted to commit suicide. Yes. Suicide became
it's pretty common.
They kind of tease suicide in the comics, because Maggie also tried to commit suicide. She actually did, and Glenn saved her. But in the show later on, and we'll talk about it next week, Beth tries to commit suicide. So that's kind of like paying homage to the comics as well. It's showing that the Green family wants to kill themselves for some fucking reason. They just want to die. So it's
like, you know, and the show, it's pretty common. You have Rick, where he finds the horse. There's a family there.
Yeah,
they kill themselves.
Yep. Michonne found the family in the show that they killed themselves. The group went in season four. With Tyrese, Daryl, Michonne, and Bob, the gas station family killed themselves.
Yep.
The guy that Daryl found in season two earlier when he opted out.
Yeah, the one inside the tent. And you also have the one hanging. I think that might be the later half there with his legs chewed off there with him and Andrew going out.
Yep.
It's different situation, you know.
it's more exaggerating to show that people are killing themselves.
Yeah.
But yeah, man, great first half of the season. You know, we had a question of basically, you know, what would the group have done if Otis lived and they found out that Sophia was in the barn. It's a great question, but that kind of defeats the purpose of having to search the way it was, you know?
Yeah, so if Otis came back with Shane, and then eventually someone would say, you know, hey, we're in this area because we're looking for a little girl. And he'd probably be like, oh, I found a little girl.
Exactly. And that's it.
You know?
There's no Glenn and Maggie. There's no... It's nothing, you know. Lori doesn't find out she's pregnant yet, you know. It kind of like is a domino effect to Otis dying. All these events happen because Otis died. So Shane inadvertently stopped the group from going to Fort Benning, you know, because he was being aggressive. You know, he made a choice. But this had a ripple effect and actually caused Shane to die. This was the moment that Shane sealed his own fate. You know, so, you know, you look at the things, these choices that these characters make, and Shane's choice to kill Otis to save Carl, sacrifices life inadvertently.
There's no way around it. Just having Sophia there, I mean, it would change the story completely because now no one has a goal besides for Carl getting better. I was just kind of like, so like Daryl, he's not going out there.
Nope.
You know, he's not developing that part of him anymore. He's just like, what am I doing here? I'm going to go hunt some squirrels then or something, I guess,
exactly.
For you guys.
I'm going to break off by myself.
Yeah.
You know, now maybe Andrea doesn't get the confidence that she needs from Shane, and maybe Andrea kills herself, you know, because she was still on that path of killing herself.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Glenn doesn't find Maggie. You know, he doesn't have that relationship with Maggie at the time, if they come back and say it. Rick, Shane, and Lori have a different love triangle. You know, maybe Lori doesn't now that Lori is showing, maybe Lori says to Shane, I think I'm pregnant, and maybe Shane keeps that from Rick and kills him, you know, tries to kill him. And he, you know what I'm saying? So it becomes a different show. It's a lot of the decisions that were made aren't made, you know, it's weird, but it becomes a totally different show. You know, they go to Fort Benning. Maybe they don't survive because Fort Benning is overrun.
Yeah.
Maybe they don't survive.
And like, no one's sad that Shane made it back. You know, him and Norris are back, so everyone's happy now. You know, the kid's saved. Everyone's all
Maybe Shane rides off into the sunset. You know, you never know.
Yeah.
So it's a very good question, but that's the reason why they have the show, is to show you that didn't happen. You know.
Yeah.
it's not gonna. You can't really have the show the way it is if that happens. It's a totally different show, and honestly, it's more of a boring show if you had that way, because everything else kind of went along plan. You kind of want things not to go as planned in this show.
Mm-hmm. We have another question though. We got time probably for one more.
What the hell was the other one? I look back. I'm sorry, guys. This question, we'll answer it. And the second part, and it goes back to what I said last week's episode, what was Lori's agenda here? You know, what was her main agenda in this whole season? And we're going to answer that next week. I'm not going to answer it right now because the dork side of me, the nerd side of me, I guess you could say, have dissected this show as best as I could. For years, because season two happened 5 years ago. What I've come up with, I'll discuss next week, but it makes too much sense. And it just goes back to human, it goes back to, you know, just primitive instincts of what a female will do to choose their mate. You know, in the wild, in animals, you know, as a mammal is what you would do to choose your mate before, you know, a natural way of choosing a mate in the wild. So I think that comes into play with season two, and we'll get into that next
week. Yeah, and still developing, so I think it's too premature right now to talk about that.
Yeah, we'll get into that
week. Covering all the rest of season two.
Yep. But definitely, this is obviously a shorter show than last week, but this also is why we're splitting it up, because we kind of like, you know, so much that we can get into, but you know, it's hold tight, because I'm gonna make you like season two. The people who are watching it still don't like season two. Hey, look, I'm gonna make you like season two. If you don't like season two, I don't know what to tell you, but I'm gonna try to drive it to you, to force you to get on Netflix and watch it again and to like this season.
Because if you haven't already, do that sometime. You know, start it back over from the beginning, and you'll pick up on so much more. You know, and try the comics, read the comics, and you get even different shades of the characters.
Because there's no other show
there. Yeah,
no other show like this, man. In my opinion, you know. So this is one of the things. And goes to say with Breaking Bad as well. I encourage people to go back with these two iconic shows, is to go back and watch the past seasons, mm-hmm. see how it connects to where you are now. And you will see that it's amazing how they do it.
Yeah. It's like, well, holy shit. Now that makes sense.
Makes a lot of sense. And just like I said, you know, just giving you that sense that they've been doing this from the start, trying to show you what these characters are going to do in the future. And when you look back, when Rick kills a little girl, shoots her in the head, you know, obviously he does the same thing to Sophia. So the producers already showed you what Rick is going to have to do soon. So they have a plan seasons ahead. So these people know what they want to do, and they're telling a story, and it's just like, hey, look, we're showing you what's happening.
Crumbs. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's incredible. And it's so brilliant. And just go back and watch it. Make sure you tune in next week to us, and I will break down the second half and why I think Lori is a conniving biatch, as they would say.
She doesn't have too many fans, I'll say that.
No, I'm not one of them.
Someone in the chat says Lori's the worst, and I think a lot of people would agree with unfortunately Andrea being a close second. But yeah, so if you like the show, tune in next time. We'll try to shoot for Monday, 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. We'll be flexible here because we are do have lives, do have work, do have kids. Well, James over there does have a kid, too, a brand new baby. So we do have to be a little flexible here in our scheduling. But I will post up there, let you give an alert there on Facebook, Twitter, Twitch. So follow us. We'll upload the video to YouTube. So if you missed last week, just go to our YouTube channel. Find us there, or check out our website, echo5studios.com. And also down below, there's a link for our charity, which is the American Foundation for Suicide Prevention. Still going on. It's ongoing until we complete it, and then we'll rotate into another one from there. If you have any questions, comments, concerns, keep the concerns to yourself. If you have any questions or comments, send them our way. And we'll try to answer them on our show.
Yeah.
So next time will be the second half of season two. And James, you have anything before you take off for the night?
Oh man, just incredible. I'm gonna probably go watch I'm probably gonna watch pretty much Dead Already after this show, because I'm still awake. I have to be awake. I gotta be on standby. You know, even though my child is sleeping through the night, I'm still on this schedule where I'm just up for no reason, like an asshole. So but I'm gonna watch pretty much Dead Already when we get off there. And you know, just like I said, you know, you can on Netflix, you got up until season six right now. What I can somebody that was one question I didn't get to, and then we'll leave it for next week. But I mean, one question I didn't get to, I want to get to now, and then we'll leave the rest for next week.
Yeah,
sure. is kind of like a playlist of my favorite episodes. And I thought that was a good idea. So what I did was I kind of made my own playlist of the episode, my favorite episodes.
Sure.
And it's amazing. I could share it with people. You know, I write it down for the people I know, or we review it. But this is one that's on the playlist. this is one of them on the playlist.
Yeah. Well, we'll get that playlist uploaded to our website, so yep. Everyone else can find it on there.
No problem, sure. Man. So everybody, thanks for tuning in, I guess, and I'll let Jay take it away.
Yeah, thanks everyone. We'll see you here next week.